Makera emailed me about their new Carvera Air, and I thought that would be kind of a cool thing because after I built this CNC machine, I realized maybe I should build something smaller, something I can mill PCBs with, because I've been making some PCBs by hand out of breadboard for various experiments, and it's awful, so milling PCBs would be awesome. And this is a sample PCB milled onto Carvera Air, and it's quite nice compared to homemade hacks. But this is actually more of a CNC router, actually more like a CNC milling machine, because it's built very solid, so I figure I should be able to do other things with it. So I'll show you the steps I went through to mill a gear like this. Now, this machine I just controlled by sending commands to the servos, so I didn't have to learn any new software, but I figured that's a bit too limiting for doing complicated stuff. So I needed a CAD program that can generate toolpaths and G-code, and because I only use CNC very rarely, I didn't want to end up with some monthly subscription, so that ruled out Fusion 360 because I make money with videos, so the free license doesn't apply. So I ended up deciding for FreeCAD, because shouldn't be that hard, right? So I designed the gear with my gear program because that's what I know best, and I'm going to export that as an SVG. And then starting FreeCAD and importing that. Now to make these imported geometries actually usable, I have to go into draft mode and then select one of these and use this button way on the right here to convert that into a different kind of geometry. I don't know why. And now both of these need to be moved into the body before I can actually use them. This is things that all took a long time for me to figure out. And now going back into part design mode, I can now take this outline and pad it, which is essentially extrude in SketchUp. And I'm going to set that to 19 millimeters because that's the depth that I want to mill. And the problem is now this is actually padded up and my shaft hole is on the bottom, and this turns out to be a bit of a problem. So I realize it's actually much easier to pad the thing down. So let's go back into the pad. Set the direction to custom direction and set that to, oops, 0, and set that to -1 so that extrudes down. And now essentially the zero reference is in the top and I still have my shaft hole here. So now I can take this shaft hole, oops, select that, and we'll use the pocket tool. It's all very slow. And clearly I pushed the wrong button here. I accidentally pocketed the other outline, so let's undo that. Undo and select this other one and select the pocket tool. And there, I've pocketed that now, but I wanted that to go almost all the way through. Not all the way through because I still need this bottom surface, otherwise I will not be able to use that to later mill a pocket. So I'm going to go down 18.95 millimeters. Just to leave a tiny bit on the bottom for the geometry. And I've got the gear shape that I can now go on to mill. Now then I went into cam mode to create some tool paths using the outline thingy here and the pocket shape thing here. And here's all my tool paths. And I was going to film that. I actually did film that. But I keep screwing this stuff up, so I can't really make a tutorial on this. So if you want to know more about how to do this sort of stuff, you'll just have to watch other people's videos. Because my advice about learning FreeCAD is, don't. Because the user interface is awful and counterintuitive, and there's a lot of things that's like, you should be able to change this, but you can't, and this doesn't work right, and this gives you a weird error. So it's an awful slog figuring out how to use this program. And I've often thought I should try something else, and researched it, and nope, nothing. I kind of like the idea of doing it programmatically. The Python script that I wrote for the other one took less time than learning this. And then I thought, hey, OpenSCAD, because it's kind of programmatically, but OpenSCAD doesn't generate toolpaths, so couldn't use it for that either. So now I've got this on here, and I set my zero position to this spot, so hopefully it'll mill the gear here. And let's click on here to start this. And it shows it's going to go here. I'm not sure if that's quite correct. And I have auto Z probe turned on, so it's going to ask for a tool change. And it'll also outline where the thing's going to be. That all of this takes a while. Okay, it's outlining where it's going to go, which is in the wrong spot. It's overlapping with the gear I've already got. So we'll have to cancel that. Just push the button up here. Okay, I just set my zero to be here, so hopefully that will work now. So let's run this again. And it shows where it is with respect to the workpiece here, so that's nice because it did a zero initially to figure out where it's supposed to go. So now it's outlining where it's going to be. Normally it does this with a probe. I'm not sure why it's not using a probe for this. But that looks like it's going to go in a good spot, I think. Not good. Cancel that. So somehow it thinks it's got the probe on there when it actually has the tool on there. So the machine does remember what tool is in the tool holder after a power cycle. Unfortunately, this time it remembered wrong. It was trying to probe with the actual cutter. And now the machine is in a state where it refuses to run any of my files. I ran into this problem actually quite a while ago, and I had to contact them and send them the error code, and they said, well, try one of our files. And it turns out one of their files, if you run it, clears that condition. Somehow the files that come out of FreeCAD, something's not quite right with them, so I can get into that sort of state, especially if I abort some operation, which I've been doing quite a lot because, oops, I'm in the wrong place or something like that. So now I just have to run one of the files that they provided, which does a bunch of tool changes, and that clears it. So now running the file for the PCB that I showed earlier, and now it's asking for a tool change. Change the tool to, okay. So at least now it knows it's got a tool on there. And I'm just gonna stop that. I'll push the button here, because I don't want to actually mill that. And I think now I should be able to run my file again. Okay, here we go. Run. Oops. Ah, shit. I hadn't zeroed the Z, so I was gonna stop that, although it looks like it was in the right spot. So now I have to go back into here. No, that's not the wrong one. I just shut it off because I accidentally closed this program, which I needed to stop the motor on here. Okay, here we go again. Okay, excellent. Now it's actually asking for the tool change, and this thing gets in the way of doing the Z probing. And this part is actually quite nice. Tool changes are really easy. I'll put the Z probe in. Get the hose out of the way. And confirm the tool change. So first it's going to hit the button here with the Z probe, which tells it where the Z probe is in the tool holder, because it could be a different depth. And then it goes where it's going to do the cutting. And it's going to touch off the material to figure out how far down the material is. Actually, first it's just scanning the perimeter. So that tells me, okay, this is a good spot. I'm not overlapping with something I've cut, other than that little boo-boo here. And now it's going to touch off the material so it knows how far down the material is. And I'm just going to do a tool change now, because it's going to ask for that shortly. There, that's asking for the tool change. I've already done that. And let's put the dust collector thing back on. And confirm. And now it's touching the tool off of this button, which tells it how long the tool is, so it knows exactly where the tool is in respect to the material. Thank you. And I just finished cutting that gear, except this thing doesn't move the head out of the way by default, which is kind of annoying. And this dust collection thing is, I think, a relatively cheap one compared to the brushes, but the nice thing is you can see through it fairly well, and it does capture almost all of the dust. And this is actually sucking through a fairly narrow hose, and I've got that hooked up to my homemade dust collector, which doesn't have nearly the suction pressure of a shop vac, so I'm quite surprised this is still able to clear it. It's kind of ridiculous here. I made this hose adapter to connect to the little wee hole in here, so I've got the 2.5-inch hose going into essentially a 3/4-inch plumbing pipe. And so now, after weeks of frustrating learning, I have myself some very precisely cut gears, much better than I can do with my other CNC or by hand. Now, I have to say, this machine is very solidly built. It uses linear glides for the vertical here and linear bearings for this part here. With linear bearings, there's always the problem of the shaft flexing, but this being a very thick shaft and the short distance, the flexing really is a non-issue. I don't like the linear glides being quite this close together, because in terms of any force coming from the cutter, that's multiplied 3 to 1 because these are so close together. Ideally, you want to put these far apart and these far apart, which I did that on the one I built. Put the linear bearings as far apart as I could without sacrificing too much range of motion. And then these two are also very far apart just to get less leverage on there. These are supported linear rails, also not great. I think this solution is much better, especially the linear glides. And the Z probing thing with this, and this thing is very nice because if you're milling PCBs, you want to get that accurate to a tenth of a millimeter, and that's the way to go there. And this lever for releasing the tool is super nice compared to using a router. And this is a proper brushless spindle on here too. And the motors on it are closed loop stepper motors as far as I can tell. I haven't looked at the other ones, but the one for down here, I looked at it, and yes, it is very much a closed loop stepper motor, which is nice because they don't lose steps and they will detect if you're falling too far out of sync. But they do actually apply quite a lot of force, which can be good and bad. So if I put the spring in here, jam that in here, and now if I move this way, that will squeeze that spring completely closed together, which is too much force for a lot of things. But of course, if you're milling metal, you want more force than that. For the vertical, it has probably a much smaller closed loop stepper motor because there's not much room in here, which is why I was able to detect that it was pushing the tool into the workpiece without completely crushing it. So I'm making this experience look very frustrating, which is not entirely truthful, because it was actually even more frustrating than I've shown, partially because FreeCAD is just such a learning curve and also getting the hang of this machine. Although since then, I've actually used it to mill some very tiny PCBs, and I wasn't using FreeCAD, and I've gotten to know this machine a little bit better, so the experience has been much less frustrating than that. And even though I ran into this weird state where it doesn't do anything for me, I haven't run into it anymore, and I think part of that is with the PCB milling, I have some tool changes in there, and I think the problem was my FreeCAD output files didn't have any tool changes in them because they only used one tool, and I think the tool change clears that weird status if you interrupted it just the wrong time. But with all the learning I've had to do to get this thing to run, like, I know how to use it now, but if I don't touch it and then I want to use it again a year from now, will I remember? Probably not. So it's like, either you're a CNC person and you build up the skills and you use them, or you aren't, in which case, every time you have to use the CNC, it's a whole learning experience again, and I'm not looking forward to that part. Oh yeah, and the milling PCBs? That's another topic for itself, so that'll be in the next video.